This is GEEKOM's Mini IT11. It is a Windows 11 Pro Mini PC that, while being really nice and small and compact, does pack quite a bit in terms of features and power, because it is powered by the 11th Gen Core i7, the 1195G7. It has a maximum turbo of 5 GHz, 4 cores, 8 threads. And this configuration that they sent out to me to review does come with 16 GB of RAM and dual channel, a 512 GB SSD from Intel, which is PCIe 3.0 spec. It has gigabit LAN for your networking and Wi-Fi 6, the AX201 card from Intel. And it can run up to 4 displays at 4K, which is really impressive. So it has a mini display out port, HDMI, and then 2 USB 4 ports, which are type C ports. So they do support video out there, the full spec one there, which is good to see. So that's how we can run the 4 displays. And despite being so small, there is even room for a 2.5-inch drive if you wanted to increase upon the current storage available. So what do we get in the box? Depending on the version, you'll have an EU or a US plug. You get an HDMI cable. We do have some screws for the VESA mounting bracket. Our power supply. So this power supply is quite small, good size to it. And it is rated with a maximum output of 90 watts. We get a little pouch as well, if you wanted to put the mini PC in that. If you're gonna be transporting it around, that's pretty handy to have. And there is a quick little instruction manual there. And finally, the bracket for mounting it on the back of a monitor. As you can see, the size of this mini PC, very nice and small and compact. It's about that of what the Intel Nooks are, and it's got a lot of ports you do get with it. So up here at the front, you can see there are 4 microphones. We have a 3.5mm headphone jack that supports microphones too with it, power button with status LED, USB 3.2 type A Gen 2, and then USB 4 ports. It's actually got 2 of them, so this can run display out too. So we get 4K 60 with that. And you see at the back, there we have another right here. So that is our second display, 4K 60, USB 4, HDMI 2.0 display port as well. So we can run a huge amount of displays on this. 4 displays in total, which is really good. Gigabit LAN and 2 USB 3.2s. They are Gen 2 ones. And then power in. So this up the top is the exit vent. That's where the hot air from the little fan in there is going to be pushing the air out from it. And we've got a Kensington lock slot, nice big vent on that side, and here on the other, a full-size SD card reader. Now, the top of it, just wanted to point out, it is made out of plastic here, but that's for the wireless antenna reception. On the underside, this is a metal plate right here, and there's this little grommet, as you can see, over each of these 4 holes. That is where you can install the 2.5-inch drive if you wanted to do so. So let's have a look at the internals, but before I just show you those internals, you can see those there are the mounting points for our VESA mounting bracket if you were going to put it on the back of a monitor. Now you just need to simply loosen off all of the 4 screws on the outside here, and you just unscrew them as far as they will go, and using them, you just pull on one of them or one corner, you can prop it up and proceed then to remove the whole back panel. Now be careful, because there is a ribbon cable, as you can see here, that is in place where we can install that 2.5-inch drive, which just goes on the back. So straight away, I can see a nice heatsink here for the SSD, which is located here. Now, this is a PCIe 3.0 spec, not PCIe 4, I believe. And we do have a thermal pad here that presses up against it to keep it nice and cool. Now, they are using a Intel. It's the 660P series. So that is, yes, PCI Express, but not for that spec, and crucial RAM. So we've got 2 sticks of 8 gigabytes here, and that is running, of course, at 3,200 megahertz. So it is in dual channel. That is great to see. Now, there should be a wireless card under this SSD. I'll take a look and see if we're able to upgrade the wireless, because I can see, or maybe it is right here, so maybe it's not upgradable. And yes, as suspected, we do have there the wireless chipset soldered onto the motherboard. It's just got the shielding around it and the 2 antennas clipped in. Now, the upgrades then that we can do are the RAM, the main SSD, so PCIe 3.0 spec. It should actually support PCIe 4, being 11th gen here. We'll have to check that out, and then add a 2.5 inch drive. Now the BIOS does have a lot of settings in here. You can see lots of different things we can tweak. Now there are some options up there that I have never actually seen before because normally that isn't shown, but you get CPU configuration options. We do have power performance, all those kind of ones that you'd expect. Chipset, system, agent settings here too that you can go through. Graphics configuration, if you wanted to allocate a little bit more to the Iris 60 graphics, you're able to do so from within here. So it is pretty much fully unlocked to us all of the normal kind of settings you would like to see on a mini PC like this. It's great that it's not locked down here with GEEKOM. There is also this very handy setting that I know a lot of people would want if you do want to run this as a server, media server or something, restore AC power loss. So you can put that onto power on. So as soon as you plug it in, you could run this on the switch as well. But if you lose power, then you gain the power back again, it'll automatically turn itself on and start to boot up. This mini PC is running Windows 11, and I'll just show you what version of it because it's Windows 11 Pro here. So the slightly better version, if you're after that, well, good news is it comes with it. You don't have to upgrade it. So we do have an 11th gen chip. It is the Core i7-1195G7 with Iris Xe graphics. Maximum turbo is 5 GHz, and it does have 4 cores, 8 threads in total, as you see here in the device manager listed 8 times. So we've got Wi-Fi 6, that's the AX201 card that I showed you that we cannot upgrade, unfortunately. And then the SSD, that is the Intel one that I did show you when we looked at the internals. Speed-wise, not very quick at all for PCIe 3 spec. It should be a little bit better here. So it's a bit of a shame they didn't go with a faster NVMe drive. It would have been nice, but of course you can upgrade this. If you wanted to do so, you could put in your own one. Now, I do have a couple of synthetic benchmarks I will be showing you. So this here is Geekbench 5. Single core score here is okay. I've seen slightly higher maybe, and multi-core. And the reason why it could actually be a little bit higher here is, I'll show you this early on, it has run into thermal throttling. Unfortunately, it's a very small little mini PC, so it's not a big surprise that it has hit 100 degrees Celsius. You can see here with HW info that, of course, did trigger thermal throttling. That's only about, well, look at that. In fact, it's on the TJ Max there, T-Junction Max. So any hotter than that, it could end up resetting, but it didn't. It will throttle itself, so it hasn't happened. It won't reset on me the whole time I've been using it, which is one thing at least. So we miss out a bit on that performance. Cinebench R23. So we're getting just over 1,400 points there for the single core score and just over 5,000 for the multi-core score. So decent power still when you think about just how tiny this is, the fact that it can run 4 displays and the RAM that is definitely in dual channel. I'll just quickly show you that. Of course, you can upgrade this if you wanted to, add it a little bit more so that you can see that under memory here. It's running at the 3.2 gigahertz as it should. That's the correct speed and in dual channel. Check that also with HW info. As for our video playback, let's just do a little test here. So my Jellyfish test file that I always test out, that starts really smooth. I'm just going to make it full screen here. And you can see, still continues to be smooth. Doesn't seem to drop any frames there, which is not bad considering this is 140 megabits per second. Sony Swordsmith, this one is 4K HDR 60. And that is looking pretty good. Like, it doesn't seem to be dropping any frames there either. No, that isn't, which is really good to see. And then what about YouTube streaming? Will it drop frames here? So I've just got a clip here that I'm going to open. This is 4K 60, I believe it is. Yes, I just put it on the 4K setting. Full screen this, and we'll check. Is it going to drop? Now, I'll try not to move my mouse around because that apparently provokes drop frames. And look at that. It's okay now and then. But it is dropping only just 1 or 2 frames. That's good playback performance there. So you don't even notice this. You'll never tell at all that it's just dropped 1 frame out of 60 every 3 seconds. Impossible to tell that. So that's good. Great performance here for video playback and streaming 4K 60.
Then what about something really demanding? I could show you spreadsheets, documents, but it handles it just fine. However, 4K video editing here with Adobe Premiere Pro, this is the latest version and update. The timeline is pretty good, but I've only got the quarter playback screen resolution here. I wouldn't really go over that because it could get a little bit laggy. Now, the speed of it, it seems to be fine. Playback doesn't seem to be dropping any frames when I'm using this resolution. If you set it to half or full, especially with these files, they're 4K 100 megabit per second is what I recorded, and it's probably going to be a little bit too demanding without having a dedicated GPU. So Iris Xe Graphics is handling this nicely, but what about now the export times? It is about to finish up now, so as soon as the progress bar disappears, 100% is gone. There we go. So you could say approximately about 37 seconds, factoring in my little delay there. So that's excellent. To do light 4K edits, it is possible with this spec of mini PC. 1080p, fine. No real problems with that. You can edit 1080p just fine. A lot better, a lot smoother than 4K. And a quick look at graphics performance. Now, normally the Iris Xe graphics does really good. You can get decent playable frame rates. 1080p is what I'm testing out right now. Now, I do have it set to normal settings. I could lower the settings down even further, but I don't think there's really too much need for that. And this is anyway my base settings that I always test on these mini PCs. So the performance is looking good, around 40 frames per second, but I have seen better, I have seen higher here. Now, I think there's a bit of throttling going on, like it was actually before in the 90s. That's probably what's caused it. So it has throttled, it's dropped down those graphics clocks there for the Iris Xe. But it still is playable, that's the main thing. That's of course what you want with a mini PC like this, that the game is at least playable. Not bad considering the form factor, just how tiny and small this PC is to play. Yes, an old game, but still a very good one. The Witcher 3, this is on the medium preset, 1080p again, and it's looking good, but it's just scraping over 30 frames per second, and this is more graphically intense, of course, being here in the city. There's a lot more to render, so when you're out in the wilderness there, the frame rate does go right up to 50, and it's a little bit better here, but I wanted to test, of course, this demanding area. So this is, it's okay, but I have seen, again, better out of the Iris Xe graphics. What about the fan noise? So I'm stressing it right now running Cinebench, and I'll give you a sample of what it is like when you push it really hard. You hear the fan, definitely audible. Now, if you've got it behind a monitor, you won't hear it as much. What I do like about the fan, though, is as soon as you stop doing anything demanding, it drops right down that fan RPM, and under idle, you can't hear it at all. It's quite quiet. It's just when you push it hard under load. So here's that sample. Then really quick here, Linux support. So I did test out here Linux Manjaro, and everything seems to be working there. The sound, Bluetooth, wireless card, all working, using their open source drivers too, mind you, to get it all up and running.
And recapping here, there's a lot on offer with this mini PC. So general kind of office performance, even light 4K video editing, as I showed you, is all possible with this, and everything does feel quick and snappy. Has an excellent build quality. The fan noise can get up there a little bit, but it's not super offensive, really loud. It's not actually too bad for a mini PC. And I like the fact that you can connect up to four displays, which is really good. And we have two Type-C USB 4 ports on this, but then we still also have three USB 3.2 ports. So plenty of connectivity options. However, it's only gigabit LAN. I really wish that that was actually 2.5 gig LAN would have been good. Gigabit LAN there would have been, you know, just a little bit more future-proof for upgrading your speeds, considering the Wi-Fi card is soldered onto the motherboard. So those are the cons there for me. And it can, if you push it really hard, like Cinebench benchmarks and just gaming non-stop on it, get up to 100 degrees C that I've seen. So it will trigger some thermal throttling if you really push it hard, which is not a big surprise to me. It happens a lot with mini PCs, considering look how small it is, yet it has a 28 watt part in here, that Core i7, the 1195G7. So the Iris Xe graphics performed reasonably in here, but I think it was the thermal headroom running into a little bit of throttling that did limit that performance there. But it is good to see that there are two RAM slots. You can upgrade the RAM if you wanted to do so. You can add a 2.5 inch hard drive, and of course the full displays with it. So it's offering quite a lot here, all running Windows 11 Pro. So thank you so much for watching my review here of the GEEKOM Mini IT11.